Hello, everyone, and welcome to this FMB webinar on Thursday, the 16th of September. My name is Hayley Lorimer. I'm Director of Membership at the FMB, and I hope everyone watching is safe and well today. Thank you very much for joining us. I'm sure you're going to find today's session really useful. This is the first in a series of three webinars that we're running, which are all about helping you to make your business work better for you, really. If you're one of those members out there who is finding themselves busier and busier, but not necessarily making more and more profit from your business, then you're in the right place to get some hints and tips about how to improve that situation. Our speaker today is Alison Warner, who is one of the UK's leading business coaches and recently won Business Coach of the Year in the British Best Business Women Awards. Bit of a tongue twister, that one. Alison's a former troubleshooter for global brands like Starbucks, but founded her Evolve and Grow coaching business in 2010, and since then has been helping construction businesses across the country to dramatically increase their turnover. And Alison's also the author of a best-selling book about how to go from tradesperson to managing director in the construction sector. And I know that that's a journey that many of our members have been on. So she's very relevant to talk to us today. So before I hand over to Alison, I just want to remind you that if any questions occur during the presentation, you can click on the Q&A box at the bottom of the screen and type your question in there, and we will address those questions at the end of the session. And please remember, there's no such thing as a daft question. If you're thinking of a question, somebody else may be thinking exactly the same thing, but you can ask the question anonymously if you prefer to do it that way. So I think that's all the introductions and housekeeping. So I'll hand over now to Alison to begin her presentation. Over to you, Alison.
Thank you very much, Hayley, and welcome to everybody who's on the webinar this afternoon. I'm just going to start by sharing my screen. So first of all, thank you very much to Hayley and the team at the FMB for inviting me on this afternoon to do the first of a short series of webinars. Just a little bit of background on myself, as Hayley's just shared with everybody. I started the business in 2010. My background is in retail and hospitality, working for companies such as Starbucks, Pizza Hut, Pizza Express, bit of a pizza theme going on there, which was not conscious. And then set up Evolve and Grow as a generic business coaching business in 2010 initially. I then joined an organization called BNI, which some of you I'm sure are aware of, Business Networking International. And from there, transitioned into working with small businesses and also construction and trade businesses. And it was the construction and trade businesses that I seemed to be helping more than others. They definitely had a unique set of challenges and opportunities. And I think my skill set suited them more than others. And it was just a sector I really enjoyed working with. So in 2017, I published a book called Build and Grow, which is how to go from tradesperson to managing director in the construction and trade industries. And it's really aimed at businesses that perhaps are the owners still maybe on the tools or partly on the tools. So relatively small, and it's aimed at helping them grow their business and then move off the tools. We do work with bigger businesses as well, but certainly the book is aimed at that target market. So without further ado, let's get into what this afternoon's webinar is about, which is how to win more of the work that you actually want. So I'd like you to imagine or think about the clients that you really enjoy working with, and what is it that you really enjoy about working with them? So this is kind of taking a step back, taking a step out of your business. And I always think, actually, when it's, you know, you might want to put some time aside to do this after the webinar, maybe over the coming week, just take some time out. And I know that's probably crazy at the moment, because I know the industry is exceedingly busy. But when you get some time off, you know, go for a walk and just, I'm a big fan of being out in nature, actually. That might sound a little bit out there, but when you're out in the woods, just have a step back from your business and have a think about, right, you know, why am I in business? What am I doing this for? what are my bigger goals? What's my bigger purpose? And within that, who do I really enjoy working with? And I would say there's three things to think about here. First of all, who do you enjoy working with? Secondly, what kind of work is more profitable for you? What sort of type jobs are more profitable? And where do your strengths specifically lie? So it might be that, for example, you have a certain specialism in maybe extensions or loft conversions. You know, that's where you're very comfortable and the majority of your experience is. Or perhaps you've got some new products and services that you would like to develop in the green space. That's becoming more and more prevalent. I'm talking about that more and more often with new clients that are coming on board. You know, they're wanting to move. They can see the future. They can see the way things are going. And they're wanting to move more into that space to be more eco-friendly and to deliver essentially what the clients of the future and some today are looking for. So think of those three things. Who do you most enjoy working with? What type of work is most profitable? And where do your individual strengths really lie? And, you know, often when we start thinking about marketing to our ideal client, before I go through the list of criteria here, some people are a bit nervous because they're, oh, I'm not going to get enough work. In my experience, you actually get more work because you appear specialist to that particular target group and your specialism. You will still attract the rest of the work should you want it. But in my experience, what starts to happen when you get your marketing right and your messaging right, and you actually state, look, this is what we do in terms of what you're wanting to do, you would start to attract more and more, and you can pick and choose. So A, you appear the specialist, and then you can pick and choose the jobs that you really want to do. So have a think about who you've worked with and who you really enjoyed working with. So they're profitable, you were really getting to use your strengths, and you were enjoying it. Maybe you might have two or three people that come to mind, or maybe they'll come to mind later. And just jot down, you know, where did they live? What kind of area was it? How affluent was it? How old were they? What did they do for a living? What were their interests? So which, perhaps they were a member of, you know, a particular golf club, or they had a particular interest. Where did they go on holiday? Who were their friends? What did they come to you for? And what did they want? So apologies, there's something there that I can't see and I can't move it out of the way. But just have a think about who they were. And we, in marketing terms, we call this an avatar. So you may even give them a name, or maybe it's a name of a client that you've worked with, you know, Mr. and Mrs. whoever. And think about, you know, all of these sorts of criteria, how old they were, where they were on holiday, what were they interested in? What specifically did they come to you for? So there's probably something that attracted you to them. Maybe you were recommended. Maybe it was something that you stated on your website that stood out to them. All of those sorts of things. Because we want to almost have an avatar. You might have several avatars. You might have two or three ideal clients, and they're all different avatars. Because once you do that, you've got one person in mind that you're speaking to. And you can then tailor your products and services to, in your terms of your branding and your marketing, which we'll come on to a little bit later. So have a think about, what is it that your ideal client wants? They'll have come to you initially for something like a loft conversion or an extension, but I'm encouraging you to think beyond that. What was most important to them in terms of the service that they were going after? You know, it's a big decision, isn't it? If you're spending a large amount of money on something like a loft conversion or extension, it's a big amount of money to be spending. And there's enough information out there in the press and media, such as Rogue Traders, to put a lot of fear. You know, I would absolutely want to make sure that that business is not going to disappear off the face of the earth halfway through the project. So it's really finding out, what are the worries and concerns? It's getting into the head of your customer. I always remember a mentor of mine saying to me many years ago, you need to have a PhD in your customer's problems. And we were encouraged to make a list of 100 problems that our clients face. And you might think, oh, I know my clients, I know the market, I've been doing this for years. But actually, it's a really good and helpful exercise to do, because you're really getting into the head of your customer to understand what is unique about them and what are their worries and concerns? What are their pain points and what are their desires? And then I'd like you to think about what's unique about you and your company. And we often talk at this stage about USPs. You've probably heard them bandied around, unique selling points. And often when I'm talking to people about USPs and what they tell me their USPs are, I perhaps wouldn't agree. You know, so I hear things like, well, we're a family business. Yeah, so are loads of others. We offer fantastic customer service. There's nothing wrong with saying that, but you need to be able to substantiate it. You need to be able to back it up with a statistic or testimonials. So it's really finding out, and you will, everybody's different. So although you might all be doing the same job, you'll be doing it in different ways. So it's really finding out what is different about the way in which you're delivering the service, or what is different about the way that you could be delivering the service. And also, what would stop your ideal client from using your services? So obviously, with your marketing, one of the challenges is attracting those ideal clients, but attracting them is the first part of the equation, obviously. So either to visit your website or to make an inquiry. The important thing is then how you manage that inquiry from there on. And there could be things that you're doing that potentially might prevent an ideal client from going any further. So how do you find out what these things are? Well, I would always suggest conducting a survey, and this should be a regular part of your processes, really, is to what I would say is best practice is to conduct a survey, certainly at the end of the project, but potentially throughout the project as well. If it's a long-term project, say 9 months or a year, so some of our clients certainly work in that space, it's a good idea to do surveys at different touch points throughout to ask for feedback. You know, I always say business is actually very simple. It's not necessarily easy, but it is actually quite, it's the simple things that make the difference. Just asking somebody, how would you rate us in these areas, for example? You know, could we have done anything better? What was your experience like when you initially made contact with us? What was your experience like when you agreed to bring us on board? And then throughout and then post project. So, and I've put here digital surveys because I think anything like this, you really want to get all of the information into a piece of software so that you can start to look at the trends in the data. You don't really want it on bits of paper and that you can't then find. You want it all in one place. There's some great tools on the market, SurveyMonkey, Typeform, other ones that we've used. And again, you know, I will say to clients, this shouldn't really be you that's doing it. Either outsource it to a VA or get your office manager. If you've got somebody in the office supporting you, get them to do it. And my personal preference is it should be done over the phone rather than just sending a link, because you'll get far higher uptake if you do it in that way. And you can also understand the context in which some of the answers are given. You can probe a little bit more to get more information. So I would then take a step back and look at your offline image and the sorts of things that I would be looking at. And again, this might sound like I'm teaching you how to suck eggs, and it's pretty simple and straightforward, but it's these sorts of things that often aren't in place. It's the basics. So things like the cleanliness of the vans, if all of your vans are sign written, if your team are wearing branded uniform, are they polite and friendly, which obviously you can ask that on the survey. How long does it take for the phone to be answered? You know, how easy is it to get hold of you? That can be a big thing. What is that first impression like? And how trusted are you as a company? Certainly a lot of those things can be covered off in a survey. And certainly if I was running a building company, I'd be wanting to keep my finger on the pulse to understand, you know, what kind of image are we portraying? How are we being seen? How are we really being seen? Because I think these things that, you know, it's very easy, isn't it, to get a little bit defensive when it's our own baby. You know, we may think we're doing really well, but really the proof of the pudding is asking your customers or potential customers how they are viewing your brand. So these are all good habits to get into doing and being open to the feedback that you're hearing. again, with the online image, things like how long does it take for email inquiries to be responded to, what your Google reviews are like, your average rating, how professional do you come across, how easy is it to find your contact details? And if I Google your company, what do I find? Do I find any other content in addition to your website? So there's a great piece of work done by Google a few years ago called Zero Moments of Truth. And it was looking at how people make buying decisions in this new digital world. And they discovered that people like to gorge on content. It was something called 7-11 for, and off the top of my head, it was something like 7 hours of content, 11 touch points in 4 different locations. And a location could be a website, it could be YouTube, that would be 2 locations. And essentially it's to build trust. So if you're wanting more of your ideal clients, yes, first of all, it's understanding, well, who is it that you wanted to speak to? But once you've got your branding sorted, then it's understanding how much is out there and available to engage with your ideal client, and how are you speaking to them via these various means? And do you let people know of any accreditations or memberships? You know, so the FMB is a key one. It's not only letting people know that you're a member, but actually what that means. You know, there is a validation process. It's not just a case of signing up and paying a fee. So how do you ensure that you tailor your offering to suit your ideal client's needs? Well, I think this again comes back to the survey and finding out what is it that is really important to them. So just to give you an example of perhaps a client that I've worked with and how this came to life, one construction company I've been working with for coming up to 2 years, he really wanted to tap into the high-end market and to grow his business and get more profitable and bigger jobs. And so it was really about looking at that whole customer journey, making it as exceptional as possible, especially in the area of communication. I'll come on to this in a little bit more in a moment, but I think communication is so, so key. And so he put an office manager in place to make sure that inquiries were dealt with within 24 hours, you know, had like that internal service level agreement, if you like, pre-start meetings with the client where they really went above and beyond to communicate how they like to work and what their expectations were, what the client's expectations were, WhatsApp groups for communication, and then a clear sign-off process. So it was really looking at those different touch points in the customer journey to then tailor it to those to that target client's specific needs. And I've touched on this already, really. It's then ensuring that your branding and your products and services reflect those needs. So you look like, if it is high-end, for example, that your website looks like a high-end website and that you're delivering. You know, there's no point in having a fantastic-looking website but not actually delivering a fantastic service. So, again, this is where the survey comes in. So just to round off, in terms of 3 simple steps that you can take, and this is probably not just in relation to your ideal client, this is just general business advice. The first one is do what you say you're going to do. There was a great book written many years ago by a guy called Robert Cialdini called Influence, The Power of Persuasion. And he wanted to understand how con men actually were influencing people to buy from them. He came up with these 6 different principles, and one of which was something called commitment and consistency. So if you actually follow through and you do what you say you're going to do, people are going to trust you more, and therefore they're more likely to buy from you. Again, it sounds so simple and straightforward, and all of us, I'm sure, have the intention of doing what we say we're going to do, but sometimes because our processes aren't as efficient or we're under-resourced, we struggle to do that. So I always say under-promise, over-deliver, because the idea is, if you can imagine, you've identified your ideal client, you're starting to attract a lot of them. If they have a great experience, they're then going to refer other ideal clients to you. It's more than likely that they'll do that. Second one, I've talked about it quite a lot, is communicate. So communication, so, so key. When things go wrong, and this is not just with customers, it's also with team members, it tends to be that there's either been a misunderstanding and a mismatch in terms of expectations, or we just haven't jumped in quick enough to find out how everything is going. And it kind of then links in with this regular feedback. So I would certainly have regular meetings throughout your projects with clients to make sure that everything is in place. If there are any problems, you can react there and then. So you're nipping things in the bud. So you can probably see I'm coming at this from a slightly different angle that, yes, it's about winning more of the work that you want. But in order to do that, your service levels need to be tip top. The exciting thing about this industry, as we all know, is there's lots of cowboys out there not doing it particularly well. So arguably, and I might get shot down in flames for saying this, but arguably, I think it's easier to stand out in this industry as opposed to some others. So the good news is if you're doing the basics really, really well, you'll be inundated with inquiries and the work, and you just want to make sure that it's the work that you want, which comes down to your branding and your messaging. I think that is it. So thank you very much for listening, and I'm now happy to take any questions. I'm going to put up this as a final slide just in case anyone wants to go and have a look at the website, and these are our social media handles.
Brilliant. Thank you, Alison. That was really interesting. Certainly agree on the nipping things in the bud point, because as members probably are aware, the FMB runs a dispute resolution service for members and their clients. So we see quite a lot of cases where communication's broken down. And that's something that you see quite often from clients. The thing that's triggered them to send in the complaint case is they're saying, oh, he hasn't responded to my emails, or they're not picking up the phone, or it causes such a lot of frustration. So that's a useful point, even though it sounds fairly obvious. It's reiterating, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. You just reminded me of another mentor, Hayley, that I worked with, and he said it's always the obvious that people don't do or don't say because they think it's obvious, but it is. It's often just about doing the simple, basic things really well.
Mm. We've got a question in the question box from Alexandru. It's disappeared, actually. There was a question asked, put it in the chat box. That's why I couldn't find it. She was responding on the point about doing a survey with clients and asking whether you had some sample questions that members could have to use.
Yeah, absolutely. They're actually in the book. So it forms part of the book, which is Build and Grow. It's available on Amazon. That's the easiest place. Sorry, it sounds like a shameless plug, but it's the easiest place to send people because it is in one of the chapters of Love Your Customer.
Yeah. Okay. Are there any little tasters that you could give members to give them, you know?
Yes, absolutely. So I would have a mix of qualitative and quantitative questions. So by that, I mean ones that you can put a statistic to, but also ones that you can have some verbal testimonials. So for example, I would be asking people to rate, for example, how happy were you with our service in the following areas on a scale of 1 to 10? And you may have things like knowledge and expertise, how personable we were, how easy we were to get hold of, you know, all of those softer skills. And then you may also have another question that breaks down the different points in the customer journey. So for example, rate your level of experience on a scale of 1 to 10 at the point of inquiry, at the point of providing the quote, pre-start job, during the job, and then post follow-up. So you're kind of breaking it down into the different touch points. So I'd certainly have some rating scale type questions. I would be asking, there's a question called the Net Promoter Score, which is used widely across all industries, but effectively it's to measure trust. And the question is, how happy on a scale of 1 to 10 would you be to recommend us to friends and family? Now, if they score a 9 or a 10, those people are seen to be what we call active promoters. If they score you an 8, they're sitting on the fence. And if they're 1 to 7, or I think maybe it's 1 to 6, actually, they're classed as detractors. So they'll be actively complaining to others about the service and your company. And so how it works is all of the detractor scores are taken away from the promoter scores, and you get an overall what's called net promoter score. great little thing to put on your website to A, educate your customers on what Net Promoter Score is and the fact that you're measuring it. My God, straight away, you'll be differentiating yourself from your competitors.
Okay, brilliant. The FMB has a suite of template contracts available for members to use. They're downloadable from the members area of the website. And alongside those, there is also a new document, which is a completion certificate for the end of the project. And it has a checklist of questions to go through.
Fantastic. So
they're not as detailed probably as you'd be recommending in that survey, but that might be a good point at which to start asking clients those questions when
Absolutely.
They've gone through that certificate to effectively sign off the job and agree on any snagging that needs to be resolved.
Absolutely. I think that's actually separate, Hayley, and just as valid. So I always say you want to be in the driving seat when you're running your business, not the passenger seat. And by that, I mean, what I often find with some builders is that they leave that end bit, the snagging, almost the customers in charge and the customers kind of leading that conversation. No. You want to be telling them right up front, right, this is how we work. This is how the job will pan out. At the end of this, what we do is we'll come in and we'll, you know, go around your home with you, reviewing everything, agreeing on the snagging and signing it off. So you want to be leading that conversation, taking ownership of it in a nice way, obviously, but you always want to be in the driving seat of your business. So that checklist is perfect. Yeah, I think it's separate from a survey. Okay. Two different things, but equally valid.
Yeah. Another question is around USBs. Can you think of something, not USBs, that's something you plug into your computer, USPs.
Yes.
So can you think of a few examples of standout USPs that some of the businesses you've worked with have developed or used?
Yeah, I'm conscious of keeping it to construction. I think things such as this client that I was referring to during the webinar where they do a pre-start meeting, and it's so, so thorough. So they even write to the neighbours. Some people may already do this, but I thought it was really, I hadn't come across it before. They write to the neighbours to make them aware that this building project is going on and should there be any concerns throughout, you know, these are the contact details. I think, again, it's simple, it's basic, but a lot of people aren't doing that type of stuff. So it's really getting, you know, a great exercise to do, and we do it in our programs, is mapping out what we call the customer journey. So it's really going into detail on and getting into the customer's head, you know, putting yourself in the shoes of the customer, thinking about, you know, what might their concerns and worries be, and going through that journey and thinking, right, if we were to completely blow them out of water, completely exceed their expectations, what sort of things would be doing. And that's how John came up with that. So that was one small thing that they did. I think it's using the statistics from the survey to demonstrate, you know, as I said earlier, a lot of people say, oh, I have great customer service. Well, that's not a USP. But to be able to say, we survey our customers regularly, and year to date, we have a, 96% satisfaction rate on this aspect of our service, or we have this net promoter score. Those are also unique selling points. But it, again, it's finding out, you know, what is unique, what are your customers most bothered about, and then developing a service to suit that.
Mm. It occurs to me that members may want to tune in and watch the Master Builder Awards. We have the final of our awards program happening on Friday the 24th. And so I'm sure there'll be some stories in amongst those award-winning projects that describe a USP that a business has
I think it's that attention to detail and that service element, isn't it? And it's those sorts of things, knowing what is really important to your customer and then how you deliver against that. Mm.
So another question, Alison, is about, we've both said right at the beginning that we know members are really busy at the moment, huge volumes of work. not necessarily resulting in huge profit margins, but still very, very busy. So their daily sort of firefighting and struggling to find the time to think about these sort of big picture type issues. So do you have any advice about when is a good time to do that? You know, just anything that would help them to carve some time out of the business to do that?
I think it's, you know, it's that whole adage, isn't it? If you continue doing what you've always done, you'll get what you've always got. And I think all of us can find at least half an hour to take that time out and to step back and to start making those baby steps. You know, you've probably got different sizes of business on the webinar this afternoon, but it depends on what support structure you've already got in place as well. And it doesn't always have to be you, you know. In fact, with things like surveys and such like, I would say it shouldn't be you, you know. Delegate those sorts of tasks. So yes, it should be you doing the thinking, the strategic thinking, but the actually making a lot of these things happen, you know, you can involve your team. And if you haven't got a team, you know, there's plenty of virtual assistants around that can help with admin tasks. And so that's the biggest, you know. I've had my business 11 years and it probably took me a long time to build my team. It was just me for quite a few years until I started branching out. But all of my team, nobody's on the payroll. They're all freelancers, but I have a team of six. And absolutely, there's no way that I could have grown my business without having those individuals involved. And I think each of them started in terms of baby steps, really. It was, you know, just maybe a few hours a month, and then it was a few hours a week. So, you know, as you grow the business, you take on more and more help, which, you know, enables you to grow.
Would you apply that advice as well to, I mean, what we're talking about here is really about members building up their own brand, isn't it? And it's about marketing their businesses.
Yeah.
And you can hire help with that, but it can be expensive. Would your recommendation be to get some expertise into the business?
Oh, without a doubt. I mean, you know, it's not my expertise as branding. I know what looks good and what doesn't, but, and you know, if anybody wants to contact me separately, I'm more than happy to put them in touch with who we use, who works with small businesses, and therefore their rates are very affordable, and that you can use them as much or as little as you want. So absolutely, it's one of the tools that we use is something called Talent Dynamics, which highlights where your strengths lie, and because of what profile you are, the strengths that you'll need to complement yours in your business. There's no way you can grow a business on your own. You have to have other people involved with different skill sets. It's we liken it to like a stool. If you think of a three-legged stool, it's stable. If it's got two legs or one leg, it falls over. And that's exactly what happens in businesses.
Okay. Well, there don't seem to be any more questions coming in at the moment, Alison. So I think we'll wrap up for today. And as you've said already, there are two further webinars that you're going to be delivering for us.
And that's right.
Talking about making customers into fans so that they help you, you know, go out and promote your own business, and also about knowing the numbers. So things like profit margins and turnover figures and things. So I'm sure that those will be useful as well. And members attending today will get an email with the dates so that they can book for those as well.
Okay, fabulous.
Okay, so we'll leave it there for this evening. Thank you very much, Alison, for your presentation.
Thank you.
Really interesting. Thank you. And thank you to all the members for attending. And we'll wrap up there and say goodbye to everybody. Thank you very much.